to be here. And another thing I wrestled with all week is this message that God put on my heart. It's one of those things where God kind of conveys to me what He wants to preach, and I have tried every way that I know how to preach something else. And it keeps bringing me back to this. How to handle pride. And from what I shared with you earlier about that meeting, you know, with the other pastors and stuff, that it's difficult sometimes. Pride is something that we all have. As we shared with our kids, it's good to be proud of them. There's nothing wrong with pride. But I think we get in trouble. I know I get in trouble. And I think that when God tells me to do something, or when God tells you to do something, and you know it's from Him, you know it's what He wants you to do in your life, so you say, well, no, Lord, I think I can do this just a little bit. Let's try to tweak what God wants us to do. And that's pride. That's pride. When we get in the way of what God wants us to do, that becomes an issue. In the Old Testament, in 1 Samuel chapter 15, the people of Israel had asked for God to appoint them a king. I'm talking about two kings today. We've been talking about David. I want to step back just one king and talk about Saul and David here for just a moment. But Saul had been anointed king in 1 Samuel 15. And there was a group of folks called the Amalekites. The Amalekites were wicked. They were hateful. They were idolatrous. They were everything that is against God. And they sold their souls for everything that is against God. Now sometimes we as believers say, you know, I like to preach the love and the mercy and the grace of God, and He is all that things. But folks, we have to understand in the scope of our lives today, at the bottom line is God is our judge. And one day when I stand before Him, and God looks at me, He's not going to see Wendell Thacker and all the sins that Wendell Thacker has committed. He's going to look at me and He's going to see what? He's going to see Jesus. He's going to see the precious blood of Jesus Christ that was shed for me there on the cross. That blood that has washed me white as snow. That's what He's going to see. When you trust in Christ as your Savior today, that's what He will see. But there will be many that will stand before Him without the blood of Jesus Christ, who have not made that decision, not made that choice to follow Jesus as their Savior. They will stand there on their own accord, and He will judge them according to their works. And they will all fall short. They will all fall short. I talked to so many folks over the course of my life, folks, my 62 years. It's long for some, short for others. But everybody, you know, many seem to think that, they, you know, well, it's all going to work out in the end. You know, whatever you believe in God's going to sort this out, sort that out, and it'll all be okay, is what they think. You know, that's not what my Bible says. That's not what our Bible says. God tells us that it's once appointed unto men. Men, women, boys, girls, it doesn't matter. It's once appointed unto his death, after death, the judgment. Will we stand judged before God with the blood of Jesus Christ? It cleanses us from all sins, or will we stand on our own? I'm glad that I've got the God's blood applied to my life today. He wants to apply it to your life, too. And He will judge. And in the case of this chapter here in 1 Samuel 15, God told Samuel to tell Saul, He says, thus saith the Lord of hosts, in verse 2 of 1 Samuel 15, He says, I remember what the Amalekites did to Israel, and how they laid wait, and how they, in the way when they came up from Egypt. Now the word of the Lord says, go and conquer the Amalekites, and utterly destroy all they have. God said, this is God saying this, I've had enough with these people and their attitude against me. Some folks, when they shake their fist at God, you know, they say, no, God, you can't do this to me. You know, whoa. You want to back away, right? Because the lightning bolt has a as the rapist, right? But that goes to show God's patience and mercy. But there came a time with these Amalekites where he told King Saul, he says, go and conquer them. You've got my blessing. So Saul went. He went. And God had given him specific instructions. Go and conquer them and just basically obliterate them from the face of the earth. This is where the pride comes in. This is the difference between Saul and David, as we'll see in a moment. Saul, he went. He did what God had said do, to a point. You know anybody like that? Who does what you tell them to do? Most of us, kids, they'll do what we ask them to do, to a point, right? To a point. I know Ken with the whole thing with the fair, and then you've got people coming and going. People always do exactly what you tell them to do, right? So they conquered the Amalekites. God said, destroy everything. Destroy their crops, destroy their animals, and destroy it all. What does Saul do? He says, well, you know, that's a mighty fine looking herd of cows. So mighty fine, you know, and these folks, they work, a good 5 months to plant all this corn, this wheat, this barley. So we're just going to gather all that up. We're just going to save these animals. And all of this gold and these jewels, surely God just wants to just dispose of that. This is valuable stuff. He improvised on God's plan. He improvised on God's plan. And he said, well, God, I know what you said, but... Does that butt ever get us in trouble? Oh my goodness. Oh my goodness. God's prophet Samuel comes along. He says, Saul, what's going on here? Didn't God tell you to destroy all of this? I hear sheep. I hear the bleating of sheep. I hear the baas. I hear all these things, and it says they're all supposed to be dead. Why didn't you wipe them out? What's the first characteristic usually of someone caught in a lie? Remember Adam in the garden? Yeah, there you go. He's blamed someone else. And if we read on in this chapter 15, down around verse 12, Saul says, well, you know, the people wanted to spare this, and they wanted to save this. It's the people's fault, Samuel. I was just doing what they wanted me to do. Wow. Samuel says, well, you know, that's all well and good, Saul, but there's a consequence for disobeying God. And that's what, one of the problems we have in America today, we don't want to feel that there's a consequence for disobeying God. We feel that we can do whatever we want, however we want, whenever we want, and continue to do it, and there are no consequences. And there are. There are. There's a way that seems right unto men, but the end thereof are the ways of death. When we do things our way, we always fall short. When we do things our way, we're so prideful that no, we will do things the way we want to, and God can just deal with it. Man, we get in trouble. Saul got himself in trouble. His high opinion of himself resulted in decisions that were contrary to God's will. As I said, when he was confronted with it, he made excuses. He made excuses. He shifted the blame. He said it was someone else's fault. What did Harry Truman say? It's our president back in the 40s and 50s. Where does the buck stop?
Here.
The buck stops here. Each one of us. None of you are going to stand before God one day and give an account for what I've done. Not a one of you. And I won't give an account for what you've done. Except for the context as I stand here today, all of these days God lets me stand and teach you as your pastor, I will give an account for the truth that I've taught you from the Word of God. Other than that, the decisions and the choices that you make, you will give an account for. He can't say, well, Pastor Wendell told me, but Pastor Wendell, you can't shift that money. I can't do it with you. Well, Lord, I would have been a better pastor if so and so would have done what they were supposed to. No, it doesn't work that way either for me. We've got to do what God wants us to do, what He tells us to do. We try to improvise as Saul did on what God wants, we become prideful. We think that our way is better than God's way, and that will never work well in our favor. Never try to justify disobedience with God, as Saul did. David, on the other hand, Israel's second king, he'd been chosen to be king while Saul was still on the throne. There in 1 Samuel 24. I mean, most of you are familiar with some of the stories around about David and Saul. I mean, Saul was literally trying to kill David. He was arranging for hunting parties with David, and he was trying to kill him. David with his band of men, they were out in the desert. They were in caves. They were hiding, literally hiding for their lives. There in 1 Samuel 24. Saul went in the heat of the day into one of these caves where David and his men were hiding. Saul didn't know it. And he laid down and took a nap. Now, I get tired sometimes during the day. Anybody else like to lay down and take a nap? You can get in there. You know what I mean? There's nothing wrong with taking a nap. Not getting on Saul for that. But there was an opportunity there for David. Here you've got someone that's chasing you, wants to take your life, wants to kill you, and God is just, David's men said, well, the Lord has delivered him into your hands. David's response was what? I will not lift a finger against God's anointed man. Another way of phrasing that would be David said, if God put him in that position, God will remove him. God doesn't need my help to do that. But David, to prove his point to Saul that he could have taken his life, went there and took his sword and cut off a piece of Saul's robe. And Saul had gotten far enough away, David ran out and said, hey, Saul! Waved the robe at him. I could have killed him. But God will deal with him. God will deal with him. Their relationship was different from that day. It wasn't Saul, but it was different. Saul had given his heart over to that pride that he thought he was right with God. David kept his eyes on the Lord. As we've discussed recently, not always. He wasn't a man that was perfect. He made mistakes. But when he did make mistakes, even when they were colossal ones, he got on his knees and he went to God and he sought God's purification in his life. Those are the things that we have to learn. We can pride in our sin. We mess up. If we mess up royally, I mean, if we mess up like we've never messed up before, the process is still the same of getting our heart right with God. And it's a step-by-step process of owning what we've done and taking it to God and confessing it. Confessing to the others that we may have hurt along the way. Saul wasn't willing to do that. He wasn't willing to do that. He wasn't willing to take that opportunity. David was. So to prevent prideful behavior, we must refuse to act independently of what God wants for us. But like David, we should handle self-centeredness by turning to God and to confession. Being thankful that He loves us enough. Gave His only Son. I'm thankful that His blood has washed me white as snow. I'm still wavering, not perfect.
Jesus Christ cleanses us from all sins.
If we accept Him, if we love Him, we make Him our own. He's what it's about. Saul never admitted his mistakes. David did. We don't admit that need, our responsibility to God, if we are downfall. How about you this morning? You know Christ as your Savior? Have you confirmed your faith in Him? Have you followed Him? Do you love Him? If not, what better day to make that decision, make that choice in your life? Admitting you're a sinner, believing that Jesus Christ died on the cross for your sins and rose again that third day. Hang the penalty. Your sins, my sins, and the sins of the world. If we will choose Him. It's a choice. It's not by chance. It's a choice you make to follow Jesus. And you know what I'm doing today?